allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Now we have a moment of silence. Okay, thank you. Now for citizen comment. Citizen comment is going to be limited to the items at hand on the agenda only. If you decide you don't want to stick to that, you'll be asked to come sit down. If you don't, you may be escorted out. Okay? So, Mr. Thompson, do you have something on the agenda, and which agenda item is it?
Anything that would pertain to the whole agenda.
No.
A specific item.
Do you have a specific item you want to talk about? If not, please sit down.
Robert, you are denying the people the right to speak.
This is a business meeting of the government.
Thank you, Robert.
Thank you, Bob.
All righty. Next one. Ellen Rollins, do you have a specific item? Mr. Rollins, do you have a specific item you want to talk about that's on the agenda?
He can't hear you.
Is your microphone on? No.
Mr. Rollins, do you have a specific item you want to talk about that's on the agenda?
I just have these things that's...
No. Do you have a specific item?
Copy of Oregon Revised Statutes 166.370.
Do you have a specific item that's on the agenda?
Yeah, this is a specific item.
If not, please sit down. Please sit down if you don't have a specific item.
It was discussed 2 weeks ago by...
I don't care about that.
Commissioner...
What I care about is today's agenda items only. Please sit down if you don't have something about today's agenda.
I just want to give each one of you a copy.
You can do that after the meeting. We'll gladly take it. For me, if it's not on the agenda, you have something you want to say, I'll gladly wait as long as it takes after the meeting to hear anything you got to say.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Francis Smith, same? You have something on the agenda?
Yes.
Thank you. Which item is it, please?
4A, under Department Heads.
Okay.
I'm Francis Smith from Coos Bay. I'm speaking in support of the Amendment Number 10 to the Intergovernmental Agreement between the Oregon Health Authority and Coos Health and Wellness for Public Health Programs, specifically for tobacco prevention and education programs. Coos County has a serious health and financial burden as a result of tobacco use. Did you know that our rate of adults who smoke here is 28% compared to 15% for the state of Oregon as a whole? We are the county with the highest rate of adult smoking in the whole state. In the nation, West Virginia is the state with the highest overall rate of smoking at 24%, and Coos County's rate exceeds that. So why should we care? Tobacco is the number one cause of preventable death and disease, cancer, heart disease, stroke, and lung disease. So it is no surprise that with our history of smoking here, that Coos has the second highest rate of tobacco-related deaths in the state. Klamath County is number one. We have the distinction of the highest rate in the state for death from lung cancer. Now, I could give you more statistics, but what is important to know is that people are suffering pain and disability due to tobacco use. There is also the expense, the loss of income from purchasing tobacco that could go towards essential needs of low-income families, the loss of income that affects a business when a key employee becomes disabled, the medical costs for the family, and the loss of family income that comes from disability and early death. I can give you a personal example. My sister's husband, a 3-pack-a-day smoker, and the primary breadwinner, had a stroke with paralysis, and my sister had to sell their primary family home to pay for his final years of care in a foster home. And for herself, she could only afford to rent a bedroom from a friend. 49% of adult smokers in Coos County said in a survey that they wanted to quit. But it is also important to know that most people start using tobacco when they are children, when the addiction is hardest to break. Coos County can greatly benefit from this additional money, which will go towards prevention efforts, especially efforts to keep youth from using tobacco and nicotine products.
Thank you. We'll take that under advisement. All right, Renee Menkins, you want to talk about public health, the same item?
Yes.
Okay, come forward, please.
My name is Renee Menkins, and I live in Coos Bay. I have been a registered nurse for over 30 years, worked in acute care, behavioral health, community health, and as a nursing faculty at OHSU and at SWOC. I'm here to support the expanded tobacco education prevention funding through public health at Coos Health and Wellness. These funds are specifically directed for teen smoking prevention programs. In our 2018 Coos County Community Health Assessment, 7% of 8th graders, so 13 and 14-year-olds, had smoked cigarettes in the last 30 days, compared with a state percent of 3%. In addition, Coos County 8th graders had a higher overall tobacco use in 2017, that's the earliest I could find the data, with 11% using any tobacco, including vaping products, in the past 30 days, compared with an 8% statewide. Over 11,792 use, about 18% of the county population in Coos County, used tobacco products per county health rankings in 2022. Tobacco retailers are a significant source for flavored tobacco products, vaping, and menthol products, and 17% of these retailers sold tobacco products within 12 inches of toys, candy, gum, ice cream, slushies, and sodas. Nicotine can harm the developing adolescent brain. Our brain keeps developing until about age 25. Using nicotine in adolescence can harm the parts of the brain that control attention, learning, mood, and impulse control. Each time a new memory is created or a new skill is learned, stronger connections or synapses are built between brain cells. Young people's brain builds synapses faster than adult brains. Nicotine changes the way these synapses are formed and can affect mental health, along with other important skills for planning, organization, and learning. Using nicotine in adolescence may also increase risk for future addiction to other drugs. Children who use tobacco products are at higher risk for mental health concerns, suicide attempts, and significant health issues, lung, cardiovascular, immune system, and other cancers. Youth are vulnerable to addiction, starting a lifelong habit of tobacco use, leading to preventable chronic health conditions. We have been aware of the impact of nicotine from tobacco use on pregnant women with fetal growth retardation, preterm birth, stillbirth, SIDS, and increased risk of birth defects such as cleft palate. The Oregon Health Authority reports that in Oregon, women up to age 24, over 16% reported tobacco use during pregnancy. However, in Coos County, reports over 23.6% of pregnant women use tobacco. Many of us have stories of loved ones who have smoked or used tobacco products and have experienced chronic health conditions or died. My mother began smoking at age 16 in the 1950s because it was cool then to smoke, and other teens were also smoking. She could never quit, although she tried many times during her life. Her smoking led to many health issues over the years until she died of bladder and kidney cancer at age 70. My husband, a longtime Coos County resident, smoked starting at age 18 and continued until he was diagnosed with colon cancer and emphysema a few years ago. However, he still cannot stop using tobacco, and he uses chewing tobacco now, even though he tried many times to quit. Preventing our children from starting tobacco use is a significant public health concern that impacts their health, their families, and our local communities. With increased health costs, over $10.4 million on tobacco-related medical care in 2022, and over $103 million in productivity costs due to premature tobacco-related deaths.
Thank you very much. All right, team. Is Mr. Taylor here, Rob Taylor?
Yeah.
You want to talk about Idaho, so that's not on the agenda, so thank you.
I want to talk about something on the agenda.
Which one is that?
I want to talk about item two, citizens' comments. That's on the agenda, right?
Yeah.
Oh, good, because I'd like to talk about this, citizen comments. Rob, by the way, Rob Taylor from Bandon, Oregon.
Just remember, this is a place of business.
Yes, and citizens' comments is on the agenda, right?
Correct.
Right.
Okay, so I want to talk about the restricted to the agenda items only, because that's on the agenda, right? Right.
Correct.
Okay, so this is absolutely ridiculous. There are a lot of things going on in this county that you may not know about, and you'll never find out about it if you only stick to item number two, things restricted to the agenda.
You can come and talk to us at any time you want after the meeting, and we'll be fully informed.
I'm talking about an item agenda, citizens' comments. That's on the agenda, right?
I got that part.
Okay, so if they're only restricted to the agenda, you're never going to find out about a lot of things that are going on in this community because you're not allowing people to talk about anything else than other what's on this agenda.
No, what I said is you can come up after the meeting and talk about anything you want that's not on the agenda.
Is
so
that
we're
after
not,
the official meeting?
Yes.
No, we need to talk
and
about
can
this
talk
stuff
to each
that's
of us individually.
On the meeting.
You can
this
talk
is
to
why
individually.
We need to talk about this stuff
Rob?
While it's on the meeting. This
Rob?
Is part of the agenda. Citizens' comments.
Rob, I already told you. You
yes.
can talk to us after the meeting, so please sit down.
No, I'm not going to sit down because this is an agenda item, and you said we could talk about an agenda
I'll
item.
I'll ask you one more time.
I'm not going to sit down
before
until I get my 3 minutes to speak on
I
the agenda
I have you
item.
Escorted out the door.
You shouldn't escort me. You will find yourself facing a lawsuit. You
I don't
escort
care
me
about
out of
that.
Here because I'm speaking about something that's a citizen's comment on the agenda.
Mr.
It's
Taylor.
A citizen's comment restricted to agenda items only.
Right.
Well, this is on the agenda. And I'm talking about item number two, which is
I got
on the
that
agenda.
Part.
This is ridiculous that we are not allowed
You're claiming
to speak
we won't
on
listen
anything
to anything else.
Else,
which is not true.
You are saying that because you're saying it's happening after the official meeting. We need to discuss
Somehow
this
Somehow I don't understand something
the
after the meeting?
Meeting.
So you're saying we don't understand anything after the meeting with that you tell us?
No, I'm saying it's not part of the official meeting. We need to have these citizen comments and to be allowed to comment on anything we choose, because this is our 3 minutes, not your 3 minutes.
No, Bob. This is a county business meeting, not a public
and
forum.
There are lots of things that have to do with the county
later on
that
this
are
year,
part of the meeting that we have to discuss.
Later
are
on
other
this year, we will have
will
town halls and
county.
You can talk about anything you want.
You know, this is the odd thing,
but
because
this
I
is
go
a
to
business
a lot
meeting.
Of other meetings and they tell you you can't speak on things that are part of the agenda item. This is ridiculous. This is an authoritarian control freak kind of thing to do. This is absolutely not something we should be having to deal with.
You can have your
everyone
opinion.
Should have their 3 minutes to speak.
You can have your opinion, but it's not the way it is. This
no,
is
I'm
a business
not having
meeting.
My opinion. I'm talking on item number two, citizens' comments. I think the Phil should have his right to come up here and talk about how ridiculous number two is and how ridiculous it is that it's restricted to agenda items only.
And your time is up. Thank you.
Thank you, and Heil Hitler.
All righty. Item 3A, sale of county forest property at county forester, Lance Morgan.
Good morning, Lance.
Good morning.
County Forester.
Morning, Lance.
Morning. Morning, Lance.
Morning. Pursuant to advertisements appearing in the World newspaper on January 24th and 27th, 2023, and subsequent hearing held this morning, should the BOC find it in the best interest of the county to sell this parcel of land, order 23-01-005L has been prepared for your signature.
So, request the signature attached of order 23-001-005L, sale of tax account 9991787, containing approximately 4.1 acres. Location is near Shutter Creek Correctional, or it used to be.
Do we need to buy time?
Yes.
Yep. So, anybody want to comment about this particular sale of this particular piece of property, which is a miscellaneous piece of property that the county has under the county forestry program. Ms. Taylor. Lewis, I'm sorry. Would you please come up, please?
What is it, like an insult?
You can either sit or stand
okay,
there. Yeah,
fine,
either
stand
one.
Up. I'm taller that way. Pam Lewis from Coquille. Would you please just take a couple of minutes and describe what's on this property and if it's open for public bid, is it, I'm not sure what we're doing when we're selling it. Is it under contract? Would you describe, please?
Council, you'll put it up for sale?
My understanding is that we'll put this property up for private sale through, probably through our county's real estate.
No, this one's gonna be on the land sale.
Oh, okay, so it'll be on the public land sale that's coming up. When is that?
Sometime April, I think you have to set the date.
I don't remember what the date is, but...
Around the middle of April.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it will be advertised...
It's a...
So the county's land sale is an auction, and it will be advertised 4 times in the newspaper before it happens. It will also be on the county's... county land agent's website stating which properties are for sale.
The county land agent went out and looked at it. It's sloping down over the hill, and the county road kind of runs around underneath of it and finally winds up to Shutter Creek. It wasn't suitable for forestry. It wasn't really suitable for, as far as the land agent said, for housing either. So it's basically a miscellaneous parcel that we're going to sell.
Okay.
And it's got to be on this alienation of county forest property because it's in the county forest. If it was just foreclosed upon, we wouldn't have to go through this procedure. We'd just put it on the county foreclosure sale. Any other questions about it? Pam?
Watch for the county's website that's land sale.
Yeah,
uh-huh.
I think the land agent has their website.
Yeah, and you could call Cole Waddington out at County Forestry, he's the county land agent, and get on the list so that you get notified.
Okay.
Or anybody else, of course. Okay. So, right, any other comments? Anybody? Have a motion?
If not, I move we approve and sign order number 23-001-005L for the sale of tax account 999-17897 of 4.1 acres.
You have a second?
Second.
Alrighty. Any other discussion? Hearing none, seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
All righty, we have another hearing, 3B, reduction of redemption period for tax proposed foreclosed property. Jill is our community.
County Council has to read it.
County Council?
I'll start with the intro, laying the groundwork. I set this in front of each individual here. This just, after my intro, on the second page, is just the different public comments and comments from staff that we'll solicit, but I'll read my enthralling intro here first. So this is a time set for the hearing on the matter of the reduction of redemption period for the following tax foreclosed property. It's 51976 Big Creek Road in Myrtle Point, Oregon. It's identified as tax account number 109511. So on December 20th of 2022, the board approved the request to initiate proceedings to reduce the redemption period for this property. The tax department has provided notice of this hearing to all relevant parties in accordance with ORS 312.1223 and Coos County Code 11.02.030. So the purpose of this hearing is to determine whether this property is in fact subject to waste or abandonment and should therefore be deeded to the county. In this context, waste means any action which reduces the value of the foreclosed property, including but not limited to physical damage to any or all the foreclosed properties or the failure to protect the foreclosed properties from the elements or from trespassers, regardless of whether the action is done with or without the knowledge of the owners or possessors of the property. Abandonment means the properties are not occupied by the owners or any person or entity that appears in the records of the county to have a lien or other interest in the property for 6 months, and the properties have suffered depreciation in value if not occupied. So Oregon law provides that if the board determines that the properties are subject to waste or abandonment, the property will be deeded to the county 30 days from the date of the board's order. and every right or interest of any person will be forfeited to the county unless the property is redeemed within 30 days.
Okay.
Okay.
Do you have pictures and testimony?
Yeah, so I'll start and then I'll turn this over to Mike, who actually went to the property and did the site evaluation.
It's hard to hear you.
I don't know if that's picking you up.
So, Jill Rolfe, Community Development Director. So, whenever we receive properties that are within that timeframe for reduced redemptions, we look to see what condition those properties are in to make a determination if the county has a case for waste or abandonment. So, I had Mike Bomber, our compliance and land specialist, go to the site to do an examination of the site, and he provided you with some pictures in the packet. There are several people squatting on the property. We were unable to locate any type of owner for the property, so that's why we asked to have this put on there. And I'll let him kind of explain the pictures to you.
So, in the packet, as you can see, just driving down the road, every picture I provided was basically out the car window. There's unbelievable amounts of trash, RVs, broke down cars, and that's only what we can see from the road. The neighbors reported, because this property's on a hillside, that there's a secondary driveway that takes you to the top side of the property, and that the neighbors have actually barricaded that driveway off so the squatters on the property would stop dragging more RVs and other miscellaneous trash to the top half. So we don't even know what's up there other than reported by the neighbors.
Does anybody want my copy?
I did pass a copy.
Oh, you did? Okay. Thank you.
So that's kind of what we know, is there's just an unbelievable amount of trash and broke down vehicles, RVs, the dwelling's not habitable anymore. That's where we're at with that.
So just to add to that, we do believe that this is, the longer it remains not in the county's possession, the more likely it is to subject additional waste, which will devalue the property.
Alrighty. Number two, any persons wishing to testify in favor of the forfeiture or redemption rights, they would like to speak now? None here? Are the owners of record here? Seeing none. Any other persons having a record, recorded legal interest in the property, would like to have comments? None. Are there any other interested parties who'd like to offer testimony in opposition to the forfeiture rights? None. Okay. And lastly, we need to adopt the order. So I would entertain a motion.
I move that the board determine that the above listed property may be subject to waste or abandonment, and should therefore approve and sign order 2301010L.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any other discussion? Seeing none, hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye, thank you.
This I should just add, this property will also go on to the
county
building.
Land sale.
Yeah.
Now,
afterwards.
A little bit more discussion about this. I assume that because it's going to be forfeiture and be on the county land sale, the county will go out and remove most of the trash and stuff? Or
that's
all of
correct.
It?
We have to evict any of the tenants that's on there and remove the trash, so it might not actually make this year's land sale. It might be next year's land sale.
Okay, but eventually it will.
Yes.
But it's going to get cleaned up.
Yes.
Okay. And if you don't know, when the county goes out and cleans it up, we take that cost from the proceeds of the sale. Well, actually, the whole land sale of all the properties that we have at that one time. And that's been, made the neighbors very happy throughout the county over the last couple of years. All right, thank you.
Before we move on, just a word of appreciation for Jill and for Mike for what they're doing. It's making a difference. Mike's been on the job already had several properties cleaned up or started in the process of getting them cleaned up. And I think it'll set a tone that will be very, very beneficial to the county. Hopefully, we'll get less of this type of property as time goes by.
He's had several chats with some property owners. Bank is one of them, and a property owner where those properties have been let go for years and years and years. And finally, we adopted an ordinance last spring. And what I said when we were talking about the ordinance was, it's not fair to the neighbors to have to put up with that stuff at all, period. Those folks, those banks, well, one was in Florida, just ignored us until we had the ordinance. And Mike, with persistence, has now got several of these properties cleaned up. They did it voluntarily, and the neighbors are much happier. So he's proceeding with others throughout the county. And if you know of some that are really a mess, you might want to give him an address so he can go out and make a contact with those. It's starting to, like John said, have results and get the county cleaned up. And like I said, over and over again, the neighbors shouldn't have to put up with that stuff.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you for the kind words.
All right. 3A, request of approval amendment 10 to IGA 169506, authorized chair to sign Peace Health and Wellness MECA.
Mike Rowley, director of Peace Health and Wellness. This is an intergovernmental agreement that in effect last year and this year, and the net change is $142,000, but the majority of it is a rollover and new funding for our tobacco prevention and education program, which Francis and Renee had spoke to. We are focusing on schools and prevention and education towards children, and that's where this funding, the majority of this funding will go to.
Okay. And motion?
I move we approve Amendment 10 to the Intergovernmental Agreement 169506 with Oregon Health Authority and authorized chair to sign.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion about this? Thanks for the comments today, this morning. With that, all in favor?
Aye.
All right. 4B, request approval amendment 4, IG 173131, authorized Mike Rowley to DocuSign. Mike.
Right. This contract is a transfer of appropriations on the state level. We have invoiced them in excess of what they thought we were going to invoice them for, and so they have to transfer money around on their end so they'll pay our invoices.
Do I have a motion?
Move to approve Amendment 4 to the IGA 173131 with Oregon Health Authority authorized department head to sign.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Right. 4C, request approval Amendment 5 to IGA 173131 authorized Mike Rowley to DocuSign.
This is basically our standard agreement for behavioral health services. It is for the first 6 months of this year at $1.6 million.
Okay, do I have a motion?
Move to approve Amendment 5 to IGA 173131 with Oregon Health Authority, authorize department head to sign.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. 4D has been pulled. It needs some work.
Does it?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
It needs the EOC combined on this, and EOC also needs access to those storage lockers.
Okay, I thought EOC was combined on this.
Nope, it doesn't say that. Well, it says memorandum of understanding between Oregon Department of Human Services of Resilience and Emergency Management, Coos Health and Wellness, and Coos County Medical Reserve Corps only.
That's the top. But if you look at the bottom where they were at, that's the sign of which was the request.
I don't see that part.
Okay.
how far in the block?
That's a signer.
I don't have all of it, but I saw it as a signer, but I don't see it in the description and what we're voting on. So we need that. Thank you.
We have it here.
For E.
For E, let's see. This one is for one of our school therapists who has demonstrated their role as high-level clinical skill, documentation, productivity standards, customer service, and they are at their top step, and we are requesting to move them to a senior clinician pay grade, and that is at step 4, I believe.
All righty. Do we have a motion?
Move to approve reclassification of Terry Adland to Mental Health Specialist 2, Senior Clinician, retroactive back to November 1st of 2022, and sign resolution 2301019P.
Do you have a second? Okay. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. 4F, request approval low quote for Laverne Park Trail Developments. Parks.
Thanks, Mike.
Craig.
Thank you, Mike.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, Craig.
Craig Storm, Coos County Parks Director. This one is an OPRD local grant for Coos County Laverne Park Trail, LG22-038. The background, the Coos County Parks have been awarded a local grant from Oregon Parks and Recreation for the development of Laverne Park Trail to the amount of $114,702, funded by the OPRD and 50% county match. We've received two quotes because there's only two trail construction companies in the state of Oregon. And the low quote was from, can't pronounce that, Pythagorean P Trails and Nature Bound Construction. And we approved the low quote for that from Pythagorean Trails.
All righty, do you have a motion?
I move we approve the low quote from Pythagorean Trails in the amount of $82,530. I got there's an extra number in here. That's it. And approve spending authority.
Second.
Oh, okay, it's 82,531.50.
Yeah.
Okay, it had a typo in the number.
Oh, sorry about that.
Okay, they had a second. Any discussion about this?
This is a trail for everyone in the audience that will start and stop at Laverne Park. Be a nice addition to the park. Part of the trail will be for handicapped access. Be a nice addition to our park system.
Yeah, it'll be 2 miles. It'll be 2 miles of trail.
I notice here that the treasurer has noted that the quote was dated for Ptarmigan was dated several years ago, so we wanted to know if that
I called and asked him if that was still good, and he said yes it is.
Okay.
He will honor that.
Good question.
Okay.
Thank me for it.
Any other discussion about this other than it's 82,531.50?
Yeah.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Right. Thank you. Next item, 4G, request approval of renewal lease with Weyerhaeuser for Nasika Park. Authorize the chair to sign. Craig?
Yeah, background, that's in the Nasika Park up on, I guess it's the East Fork of the Millicoma River. Approximately 18 miles out of Coos Bay, up just shy of Golden Silver Falls. It's a well-traveled area because of the state park up there. And we've had this park since 1978. Mm-hmm. We started the lease agreement with them back in 78, and it used to be a 20-year lease. But then in 2018, they decided that they were just gonna go to 2-year leases. So we're able to sign the 2-year leases, but now it's come up again, and they were actually going to try to take it off of the lease and sell it, but they took it off of the land sale, excuse me, and they offered us to keep the lease going for another 2 years.
They had it up for sale, apparently. Huh?
They are going to put that surrounding property, I guess, warehouse is up for sale.
Okay.
The county does own 15 acres adjacent to this. That was given back to the same time in 78. It's our day use area, the area just before the park.
Okay.
We have 15 acres. We have the river access plus the forest land up on the hill.
Now I can't remember. Is there driving access to the county portion?
You drive right through the lower part of it. Yeah, okay.
But do you get to it through Nasika or?
No, you can't before.
Yeah. It's all by itself. Okay.
Yeah, there's a trail between Nasika and the county's day use area, which mm-hmm. we own, that connects the two. They sit adjacent to each other.
Okay.
So there's a trail that connects the day use to the campground.
Now, do we own where the water supply used to be across the?
No, pavement? Warehouse owns that.
That's Warehouse. Okay.
Yes, across the road. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. If by revenue wise, that park makes about $9,000 a year.
Okay.
Just from camp fees only, and that's $16 a night. So that's quite a few folks that actually use that park. And there's generations of families. You know, I've talked to many people that that their grandparents and their parents, and now they're bringing their kids mm-hmm. up there. And it has helped a lot since we put in our new host up there. He's cleaned up things a lot. He's gotten rid of all of the partiers and all that kind of stuff and turned it back into a family type atmosphere.
Mm-hmm.
He's built a bunch of barricades along the bank so that people aren't falling off of that steep bank down to the river that's in the campground. And we do have 24 sites there. They're all primitive sites. There's no water or electricity, but there is non-potable water to the host and electricity so that he can have some sort of modern way of living
mm-hmm.
With it, even as far out as he is living there. So I'm requesting that the chair sign the new two-year lease agreement with Weyerhaeuser to keep the park open for the people to use.
Alrighty. Do we have a motion? Or did we already do that?
No, we haven't.
I got to listen to Craig's story and forgot.
I move that we sign a new 2-year lease agreement with Weyerhaeuser for use of Nasika Beach for discussion purposes. Park.
Yeah. Do you have a second on the park?
Second on the park.
Okay. Any other discussion? I know a lot of the steelhead fishermen like to
yes,
go there.
Yes, it is a very popular steelhead spot.
Pam Lewis?
Thank you, sir. Pam Lewis, I'm a pro-park person. I would like to see some research. Why don't we buy it from Weyerhaeuser if they're interested in selling it so that we have a combined park and more access for our people? Just a request from someone who loves parks.
Right? Yeah, would you talk to me afterwards if there's some other extenuating circumstances?
Craig, did Weyerhaeuser give us an indication of the price?
No, they did not. I think they were just, because they own that upper section right above the park there with the road bisects, and I think they were just going to lump that 11 acres into that other 14 acres they had up there.
Mm-hmm.
And because if you click on the assessor's map, it'll come up, that whole section comes up as owned by Weyerhaeuser, and then LEC is Coos County.
Okay. All right. Any other discussion?
I have some discussion. I have some concerns about this. That park, although the park, what do you call it, groundskeeper,
host
is doing a good job in the park itself, where he lives is absolute trash. Nothing for this county to be proud of. And he's the best person we've been able to find, unfortunately. And we worked hard at trying to find someone to do that job. We need to put money into that park, and if we don't own it, and Weyerhaeuser's announced the intent to sell it, we don't have the money to buy it. I think I just didn't see us close that park down. So I've made the motion, but I'm inclined to vote against it so that we can study this and decide with a little more thought, you know, whether we want to keep the park or for another 2 years or try to buy it.
We know when the possible sale is?
Do not. They didn't give us that information when they planned to.
So if we renew the lease, obviously it's off the table.
Yes, that 11 acres is off the sale for sale. Yeah.
Unless they give us notice in the lease, like 90 days or something, that they're going to sell it, then it would be leased for 2 years. Do you know what the, we don't know, do we? No, so.
And what you mentioned as far as money is our gross, is it not?
Yes.
We don't have a cost accounting system that really tells how, what we net on the park. And keep in mind, we have union people with PERS benefits, health benefits, and when we dispatch them in the morning here at 8 o'clock, they've got at least an hour's drive up there, probably more, time to load up their equipment. They probably start working at 10 o'clock, and then at 3 o'clock, they reverse that and come home.
And it costs. Well, the solid waste truck goes up there at what, roughly 5-6 miles a gallon.
So we've got.
Plus the driver, of course.
Well, I don't know unless how far the state, it is, but long waste management takes care of that.
Oh, do they now?
Yes, waste management does.
Oh, cool.
Does, yes.
But
yes.
Pumping, we do have to pump out the.
And we have out.
Vault toilets.
Yes, we have vault toilets there that Roto-Rooter services for us during the summer and the peak camping season.
Okay. I know John was talking about the kind of the unsightliness of the manager, but before that, we even had a bunch of homeless camps there that the previous quote manager was allowing to stay there. So it's been kind of a problem, and then they had, if I remember right, some conflicts with people trying to use the park, fishing, you know, picnicking, whatever, and that didn't go so well. Because it's a long ways up there for anybody to patrol that.
We've had suspicions that we've not been very diligent in collecting rent for people that use the park at night. It does serve a purpose. It's where a lot of people in that area take their garbage, so we get to pay for that. I think we ought to take a look at it and look at not re-signing this. And I'd like to bring this back up. Do we have a month to do this?
Yeah, I think we have at least 30 days, yeah. Actually, I think it's March 31st is in my head for some reason. I think that's our end date.
I'd like to have
there should be, we should send a contract over to review.
Yeah.
To review, okay. So I'd like to read at least, maybe council could peruse over it too.
And I'd like to see, have the other two commissioners visit the park to see for yourself what it is. Keep in mind that we're going to still have a piece of property that people will be able to park on and fish from. Is that not right?
The day use area, right.
And I don't think Weyerhaeuser is going to fence that off and say that fishermen can't walk from our property onto their property to fish.
Well, they do charge you to hunt and some other stuff on their property. You pay for a fee for a permit. They ought to know about fishermen.
That would be up to them.
Yeah,
but, yeah.
They do that, yes.
Yep. So they may charge to go on their land.
Access fee, yeah. For any of their properties.
Okay. So I don't know what the annual cost is on this lease.
It's about half, $4,500 is what it cost us to go up there at least once a week. You know, the consumable goods, the toilet paper, the cleaning supplies, electricity, and so forth to make the pump run and for his RV.
How much are they charging?
We're not paying for the property.
We don't pay Weyerhaeuser.
That was the right question.
No, we don't pay them.
Right.
Yeah, this lease is a
there's nobody involved on the lease at all.
Okay.
Fuck that.
So we want to make sure. Maybe put this off until next meeting?
Good deal.
So everybody has a chance to read the lease and stuff?
Yeah.
You have a motion for that?
Yeah, please.
Hey, I move that we table this agenda item until the next BOC meeting pending further review.
Second?
Well, we have.
Well, oh, wait, I'm sorry.
I put it out to, let's put it out a month, give ourselves time to get facts together.
Okay.
Rather than 2 weeks.
Amend my motion or 1 month down the road.
Okay, there's a second on the amendment? Okay. Any other discussion about Naseka Park? Okay, so we will table it for a month. Thank you. All in favor of tabling?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
All righty. 4H, request approval of resolution making additional appropriations and approval to purchase TrueNarc instrument for Sint Sheriff.
Good morning, Sheriff.
Good morning, Commissioners. So this, both H and I, actually, these next two agenda items, we were approved 2 weeks ago by the Commissioners. That's the grants we got from the Coquille Tribe. But we failed to put on there the spending authority for them. So coming back to you for that. On H, the first one is for the TrueNarc machine, that machine that will can give us presumptive positive results from drugs that we find in the field. So we're hoping to increase the spending authority to $20,000 and asking for your approval.
Motion, please.
Move to approve and sign resolution 2301024B to authorize purchase of the TrueNarc instrument per quote.
Second.
Okay, discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
All right, 4I.
4I is, again, another approved grant, so $32,689 for operating costs that the Coquille Tribe gave us for Sint operations. We have it broken down there a little bit by the spending, or the line items, excuse me, 2001, 22, 27, and 6001. Spending authorities, respective, $6,689, $10,000, and $16,000. So, requesting approval for spending authority.
Motion, please.
Move to approve and sign resolution 2301025B.
Okay, second?
I second that.
Any discussion? No?
Aye.
All in favor? Aye, yeah.
I'd like to acknowledge the Coquille Tribe for their generosity.
Mm-hmm.
Just one example. Year after year, they're supporting our public safety.
Absolutely. I went to the awards banquet ceremony on this last Friday. It was $850,000 is what they gave out to various organizations throughout the county. They've done
wow.
Some great work with that.
Very good. Well, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Sheriff.
All righty. 4J, request approval resolution making additional appropriations for the fair. Does anybody know about this thing?
I think the treasurer does. All right.
Okay, John.
We have had some donations made to buy and install an additional bleacher at the rodeo arena at the fair. This will replace the bleachers that we took out last year in order to reconfigure the way the rodeo arena functions, and it's been a really good improvement. And I think what we're looking at here, how many dollars do we have? Well, just $22,500 that we're looking at. So I move we approve and sign resolution 2301-017B.
Okay. Do we have a second?
Second.
To accept donations for the fair bleacher project.
All right. We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Anybody? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. 4K, request approval job description for director of Coos County Homeless Response Office. And post and fill position community development, Jill.
Thanks, Jill.
Okay, so House Bill 4123 is a general fund grant provided states that the recipient shall enter into agreement among the recipient. So the City of Coos Bay, North Bend, and the county entered into this agreement And part of the receiving the $1 million grant is we have to hire a homeless response office coordinator. I guess that's what we're calling them. I'm part of the advisory board, that's why I'm presenting it. It really has nothing to do with my department itself. So, so I worked with county council and with the advisory group to put this job description together. Originally, we had went out for an RFQ. We didn't get what we were looking for, so now we're looking to put this as a contracted service position in. And the advisory board has signed off on this description, but the Board of Commissioners actually has to adopt the description so that we can actually post and fill it. And again, it's contracted services through either Barrett, Cardinal, or one Atlas, one of the employment agencies, so it does not have PERS or full benefits attached to it.
Mm-hmm. And we have received sign-off from the ASME union that they don't have an objection to this position existing for a couple of years.
Yes, it is a temporary position. It's not a permanent position. It is a temporary position that goes with the grant funding that's available.
Okay. So I have a motion for this?
I move to approve the job description for the Director of Coos County Homeless Response Office and allow for this position to be posted until filled.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion about this?
How is the advisory board comprised? How are those seats selected?
So there are two from Coos County, one from North, but no.
Two
from each one. So John Sweet is your appointed board member, and I'm your appointed staff member that serves on that. The board has to appoint who serves on it. And then for the city council determines who sets on it. And I think they each have one city councilor and one staff member.
Mm-hmm. And that's pursuant to an IGA that we signed last year with North Bend and Coos Bay. Mm-hmm. We're required to have this advisory board under this grant that gave us the funding for this as well.
And this, we were chosen as one of eight counties, I think,
yes, that's
in the
correct
state to be awarded $1 million to come up with a plan.
Yeah, the whole purpose of this is to put a strategic plan together and then put steps to implement that strategic plan. The strategic plan has to be reviewed and adopted as well, my understanding. Right now we're at this step where we have to provide for this director.
Okay, so any other discussion?
How does the homeless response board interact specifically with the programs that the cities are emplacing? For instance, the program discussed at the North Bend homelessness town hall last night. How does this interface so we're not running two separate wheels here?
So the idea of having representatives from each of the cities and the county is so that they can be the liaison to their councils and we can be the liaison to our board, so that way we're not duplicating processes. But if you had a specific concern that came up in the meeting yesterday that I wasn't at, I'm happy to answer them.
And the other thing is, ideally, we'll see how it goes, but ideally the director here could serve as a central point of contact, and part of what their job is that they should know if North Bend is doing something with relating to homelessness, and they should have a contact in City of Coos Bay, Coos County, that they will relay that information to, and you know, that's part of this individual's job.
It is.
To make sure that everybody knows what everyone else is doing, so we can all be on the same page.
That's why it's important to hire just one person rather than to have your advisory board going around and being the liaison. So this person will serve as the point of contact for all of that information.
Okay. One of the requirements of the agreement that was signed to get the $1 million is that there would be a large amount of public input provided. this project, and we have hired the
RDI.
Group has hired an outside contractor to do that work. It's a rural development initiative, and it's being, the work itself is being done by the person, an employee of theirs who is very familiar with Coos County.
The public sentiment work you're talking about.
Yes.
Commissioner Sweet, you need your microphone, sir.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'll get a little closer.
I was just explaining
that the $1 million grant that we received from the state requires that before the county and the cities come up with their strategic plan to deal with homelessness, that we have to have a lot of public input from a broad range of sources. And RDI, as the Rural Development Initiative, has been contracted with to do that on behalf of the group.
You had a question in the back of the room.
Oh, where? Oh, Mr. Taylor, come on up.
We keep hearing about the homelessness, and from what I've seen from the governor, all she's talking about is the redistribution of wealth from the people who have it going to the people who they consider homeless. That would be just fine if we were talking about only good, decent people who've fallen on bad times. We don't have a problem so much with homelessness, we have a problem with lawlessness. People are not being prosecuted for the crimes they commit. It's a revolving door on the sheriff's office, not just because of what the sheriff's done, because of what the law has created from the legislature in Salem. So we need to stop just talking about the homeless problem, because the problems in the street, those people are homeless, but they are drug addicted people who need to be either institutionalized are put in prison. So I hope that is a bigger part of the discussion, because that is the main problem that everyone is complaining about, and that will be validated if you watch the video from the North Bend meeting from the community center last night. It's not the homelessness, it's the lawlessness. And that's my comment. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think a big part of this is to identify the underlying causes of homelessness. And I agree with Rob, a lot of it is addiction, a lot of it is mental health issues, and if we don't deal with those, we aren't going to deal with the problem properly.
Well, and I would agree with Rob Taylor that with the legislature in the last few years liberalizing the drug laws and also releasing people out of the state prisons by the hundreds, if not thousands, and not only from regular incarcerment, but from the mental portions, that has created a huge problem for most of all the cities in Oregon. And that's happening in California and Washington State, et cetera. So studying this thing to death, it's just round and round and round again, and it never gets anything accomplished. And like Mr. Taylor said, and I agree, that you didn't become homeless first in most cases, you become an addict first, and because you're spending all your resources on that instead of paying your bills and your house payment or rent payment, then you become homeless. And then to support your habit, you have to go out there and do things against society, and it creates a massive problem. But studying this thing to death doesn't get it for me. Sir, come on up.
I think there is a way to...
Name and...
Oh, my name is Greg Spores. I live in Bandon.
Okay, cool.
And what I find interesting is shipping problems to other areas. The migrants being shipped to New York, now New York is shipping the migrants to Canada. All we need is a consent form from an American citizen who desires to live in an area where the government is going to supply funding for these needs. And we could move homeless people to Portland, which is going to get $9.4 million from the federal government, or any of the 11 counties that our governor is going to send funding to for these issues. So we could put pressure on our government to address these issues equally throughout the state, or finally just to really address the issues we're talking about by applying more weight for them to take care of. If they're only going to take care of the homeless issue in 11 counties, then we should be more than willing to inform our homeless community of the benefits, to ask them to sign a consent form to move, and then provide a bus. It'd be much less burden on the county than solutions that are gonna end up going nowhere and just cost the county more money.
You know which 11 those are?
What's that?
Which 11 those are? That they got the funds from the governor? I know we didn't. The 11 counties. Do you know which ones they are?
I just know it's not Coos County.
Yeah, me too.
I know it's all of the liberal counties up north, and then I think two counties over in eastern Oregon.
And I think none of the coastal counties got any.
No, right. None of the coastal right. counties, none of the far eastern counties. Most of the red counties got left out.
As I understand it, the left out county who are represented by state reps and state senators are very upset about that.
Yeah. So spending our own money when the money that's allocated for this, I would drive a bus. I mean, it just seems like a humanitarian thing to do. If Tina Kotek is going to house people in Salem, then we should look at that. Where is this housing going to take place? Can we help these people out to receive benefits?
Mm-hmm. Greg, I appreciate your comments. They're really good. But two points I'd like to make. One, this isn't our own money we're dealing with here. This is $1 million.
You always say that.
When I say our own money, I mean money that is coming to the county directly. I mean that we charge our citizens for. This is not county tax dollars. This is a grant we have from the state, which is your money, I think.
Yeah, I saw a report that said over 200,000, 200 million. The tax dollars coming out of county, we only received
$223 million that Coos County residents pay in federal taxes.
Right.
In 2020.
Mm-hmm.
So
the other thing is that part of the solution is a better. We always wanted to jump to solutions before we really know what the underlying causes are. This project will try to address the underlying causes. I can tell you that we've jumped ahead already, and one of the solutions that has come up is we need to have money so that people who have ended up here with these issues have an opportunity to be transported to where they come from, to their hometown, their home community, where they have family, and other support. So that idea that we should ship these people away is being talked about, and that's part of the things that are coming out of this discussion. Yeah.
If it's beneficial to both.
Yeah.
We also need to look at what are the numbers of illegal residents that are homeless.
Yeah. And all those things are going to be looked at in this.
Thank you.
Thank you
for
your comments.
Sir? You had your hand up over here.
Douglas Jones, Coos Bay,
mm-hmm.
And Commissioner Sweet just said most of what my comment was going to be, that this is grant money. This is for the purpose of hiring a person who would coordinate efforts to look at the homeless problem in our county, in coordination with other local people, to come up with ideas about how to best address it. And I think it would be foolish to not fill this position and use this grant money for the purpose that it's been identified to be used for. A lot of people are giving their opinions, but not a lot of facts are being thrown around in the process. So I don't see why there's all this discussion about filling this position with grant money. It makes good sense to me. So that's my comment. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else?
I just had one thing I wanted to
say. Jill?
So this is a community problem. And even though the intergovernmental agreement is between Coos Bay, North Bend, and the county, it does not exclude the rest of the cities. In fact, we're supposed to bring the rest of the cities in the plan. Mm-hmm. So if you don't have a community, obviously we have a community need, or we wouldn't be searching for some type of solution, regardless of what that solution is. So.
Okay.
I think this person probably fulfills at least getting us the discussion points, and if we don't have that happen, we're never going to find a solution.
All righty. Anybody else? Or you want to come up again? Rob? No? Okay.
Just as an interesting point to ponder, I wonder how much more money we could have available to deal with homeless issues if our state prisons stopped their program of providing free sex change operations to people with sex dysphoria.
Yeah, there's all kinds of issues.
Yeah.
All right, I guess we are ready for a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right.
Thank you.
Moving on to 4K, request approval of job description. Oh, no, I did that.
Yeah.
4L, request approval of inclement weather policy, county council.
Yes, so this was something that we discussed in December, and I guess I put it off for a little while. We discussed having a inclement weather policy to cover situations, you know, snow, ice, and things of that nature. At that meeting, the board decided that they would like a policy that stated that county facilities would generally strive to remain open, as opposed to using the model that, you know, school districts typically use of delaying based on weather conditions. However, if employees are unable to safely report for work or otherwise delayed by weather, then it becomes a decision that can be made at the supervisory level to decide whether individuals need to come in or not. And then, of course, we do recognize that we have some employees that, regardless of the weather, will have to come in, and that would be people like folks who work in public safety or the roads department who have to be out in the field.
Okay. We have a motion.
Move to approve and sign resolution 2212-248L adopting the Coos County inclement weather policy.
We have a second.
And I second that.
Now for discussion. Any discussion?
Can I count you a describe this real quickly?
Yeah, that might be helpful for everybody to see.
I mean, it's so basically, it's the policy of the county to remain open because we want to keep providing the services we have to the public to the greatest extent possible. Employees who are unable to safely report can use leave after speaking with their supervisors. In these cases, employees may use any accruals or leave without pay at their choice. Some county employees will need to remain at work even in inclement weather to perform essential county services. Those are staffing decisions that are made at the department head level with regard to who's essential and who has to be here. You know, off the top of our heads, we can imagine if you work in the jail, you need to be here because there needs to be staffing there. In instances where there's issues relating to weather, many employees in the road department would have to report as well because they need to respond to things like blockages of the roads and things of that nature.
Righty. Did that bring Ryan any questions? Okay. Hearing no other discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All righty. 4M, request approval of resolution 23-01-018P.
Okay, so we're requesting the board to approve reclassification of the HR office assistant position from pay grade 411 to 412. This reclassification will align the position with the current pay grade for the roads department office assistant. The HR office assistant and the roads department office assistant were in the same pay grade. We reclassified the road department office assistant, but we did not do so for the HR office assistant, so we believe it would be appropriate to do so. Additionally, our HR office assistant has been taking on more responsibilities, doing everything necessary to input all new hires into the county's payroll system, which is, I've seen it and I do not know how to use it, even though it's part of my office. It's more complicated than it should be. Also, administering employees into the OEB health management system and making all changes necessary there. So we have about 120 AFSCME union employees who are in the OEB health management system, and we have no broker who handles those, so those all go directly through Karen in the HR office to make any changes necessary there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so motion?
I move that we approve reclassification of Karen Frazier as requested above and approve and sign resolution 23-01-018P with an effective date February 1, 2023.
Second. Okay, any other discussion? Hearing none, seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
All right. 4N, request approval of cooperative improvement agreement with ODOT and the City of North Bend County Council. Again.
So ODOT intends to complete pedestrian improvements at the intersection of Marion Avenue and Cape Arago Highway in North Bend. ODOT will completely fund all pedestrian improvements. This agreement would simply allow ODOT to enter upon county property adjacent to the project and use it for staging as necessary to complete the work. And this is a tax foreclosed property that the county owns, and it's not slated for sale anytime soon because there's some mitigation work going on there. So we don't really have any intent to utilize that property for a good period of time.
Okay, do I move it?
Yes, I move we approve the cooperative agreement between ODOT and the City of North Bend.
Second?
And ourselves, I guess.
Second. All right, any discussion? This is the property that's the abandoned gas station just west of Safeway in North Bend on Virginia. It is going through DEQ rehab and cleanup at this time. At some future date, that will be probably on the county auction list. It's a 100 by 100 piece of property. It fronts on Marion and Virginia on the southwest corner. Okay, any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, thank you. 4O, request approval of commemorative naming of the new maintenance building. Rod.
Last year, Denise Harris, a county employee in the assessor's office, offered a deal to the county to purchase a building that had been occupied by her husband's business down the street here at 142 North Adams, and offered it at a very generous price. In addition, provided quite a bit of inventory for the benefit of the county that was inside the building. The county's going to realize substantial financial benefit from selling off a lot of those items, and in recognition of the generosity of this offer that we took advantage of, I'm proposing that we name that building the James Harris Building, so that the memory of James and Denise Harris would live on.
Okay, so is that in the form of a motion?
I move to adopt this resolution to name the building at 142 North Adams as the James Harris Building.
No, second.
I'll second for discussion.
Okay, discussion. John.
Well, I have concerns about doing this. First, it wasn't James who made the building available to the county. It was Denise.
He had passed some time before that.
Secondly, it wasn't a donation. We paid for it. And I think we paid a fair price for it. Maybe more than a fair price. And I don't know that we have any special thoughts about or rules about when we do name something on behalf of someone else or when we don't. But it just doesn't seem that James has risen to the level that he needs to have his name on that building. Again, I'll report it wasn't he who donated the building to us. Two, it wasn't a donation, it was a sale. And three, it turns out that although we thought we were getting a pretty good deal, I don't think we did. In fact, we might have got a bad deal. Because it needs a lot of repair. So, I hate to set I'm not against doing this, but I hate to set a precedent where we name something after someone who's actually done so little on behalf of the county with regard to this specific property, at the very least. I don't know beyond that.
Ron?
Well, my on-site assessment of the situation was that there was a substantial amount of high-value inventory that was included as a donation on top of the mm-hmm. purchase, which and the purchase price did seem to me, not being a real estate appraiser myself, but it did seem to me as if it were a very advantageous purchase price. But addressing the name of the building as opposed to who donated it, I would posit that Denise Harris would be quite more delighted to have her husband's name on the building than her own, as indicated by the tears that she shed when I shared with her the news that this was going on the agenda item. So I'm certain that Mrs. Harris has no objections to the specific naming.
For me, I used to go over there and buy a lot of woodworking equipment, saw blades and router bits and different things. And I always know him as Jim instead of James, so I was a little bit confused about that. But I guess his given name is James, but to me it was always Jim.
Well, I'm totally willing to amend my agenda item to indicate the name of Jim, but
either one. Mm-hmm. But I always knew it was Jim. He was always very helpful and valid. Mr. Taylor?
Taylor from Bandon. I don't know who Jim, James, or the other lady is. If they donated a building, then just the fact that we appreciate what they've done should be well enough, because you've got to think about this. I work at the radio, on my radio show, in a building called the Hall Building. Mr. Hall was a member of the Ku Klux Klan. So you may want to think about who this guy is before you start naming stuff. I mean, later down the road, we find out some strange things in his background. That's going to be used against you, because I'm still called the Grand Wizard of the Coos County KKK, and they always use me being in the Hall Building as a reason to do that. Just a thought I'd put out there. Thank you.
So, based on that comment, do we know a lot of background about Mr. Harris? I don't, other than going in and buying stuff from him.
You know, no. I didn't know Mr. Harris. I know the gesture that Mrs. Harris made in generosity to the county. I know that Mr. Harris had a positive reputation in the community, and that the offering of the building at the sale price that it was offered and the additional donation of over $80,000 worth of inventory that's in the building warranted some special mention, in my humble opinion. And I would additionally say that anyone who refers to Rob Taylor as the Grand Wizard of the Ku Klux Klan because of the building's history is a fool, and our decisions should not be informed by foolishness.
Yes, ma'am.
Susan Kaikendall out of Coos Bay. It's just a simple thought. Is it possible, instead of naming a building, can you just simply put a plaque of appreciation? You know, future, if something were to come up that would be disingenuous for the thought, it could be removed, but it would still be honoring, but not a formal naming of a building. Just a thought.
Okay,
thank you.
Anybody else? Anyone else have a thought about this? Yes, please, come on. We need to have it recorded, is what's going on.
Who knew such
so name and general location where you live.
So my name is Kathleen Swanson. I've lived in this area for going on 4 years.
Uh-huh.
And I'm just a couple blocks from here where I have my business.
Oh.
And since before I arrived, the building you're talking about has a ceiling with black mold that's falling in. It looks to me like it should be torn down. How do you know it's going to keep standing? And if there's inventory in there that the widow received after her husband passed on, shouldn't know what to do with it. It's kind of convenient to donate it and get a tax write-off. So I don't see the whole picture yet. It looks like this is too quick of a decision. Is that building gonna keep staying? Is somebody gonna fix the roof finally? Like, what's going on with that building right now?
Yeah, you know, it has a great
what condition?
Big blue tarp on the roof.
And black mold inside.
It's been flooded several times, yes.
Yeah. I think it should be torn down.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else want to comment about the building or the naming or whatever?
I'll comment on the maintenance and repair of the building. The county maintenance staff has a solid workable plan for the repair of the roof, which is in bad shape. There's no doubt about it. Yes, there have been other problems with the building pursuant to the roof failure. That was a lack of maintenance over a long period of time, but I have every confidence that our maintenance staff has a sufficient and workable plan to repair the roof, and I think that tearing the building down as it stands would be an economically unfeasible action.
Well, the other thing too is maintenance really doesn't have any place to work.
That's right.
To construct things, whatever, and that was a cabinet shop at one time with a front office, or two front offices actually, the sales and then the private office, and in the back, it has a drive-through from the front all the way throughout to the back of the other street, which is really ideal for county maintenance to do any kind of construction they need to do off-site, like they built this old dais here. But really, they were working in the back over here behind planning and behind county council, a little tiny cubbyhole space, and they had a little bitty space in the basement of the courthouse where they had a cut-off saw and some hand tools, and that was about it. For this would be a space where they actually do work for all the county buildings throughout the county, which we have a bunch of them. Anybody else? Mr. Assessor, Steve Tanzer, with his bum knee.
Steve Jensen, Coos County Assessor. The fact is, it's a great building in a great location with a bad roof. To tear it down is going to cost a bundle of money. To rebuild it is going to probably, in my estimation, be 10 times what was paid for it. Now, if you have some other facility, I'd like to hear about it. But it was given huge donation, and maybe you should list through the items, the machinery, the equipment that was inside that was donated.
I know there's thousands of items that were hand tools and that sort of stuff, drill bits, all that kind of stuff.
The small hand tools, the small bits and blades, but edgers, routers, saws, all that. And that was very substantial. I don't know if Jim would care if it was called James Harris or the Jim Harris Building, but I think the donation, in addition to the very fair purchase price, I think it should be acknowledged.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Jansen, you stated that the value of the building could be 10 times what it is with the repair of the roof. What qualifications do you bring to make that estimation?
To rebuild.
That's a joke, Steve.
Being the county assessor and all, you're supposed to know the value.
That's right. That's right. I think to rebuild it would cost approximately 10 times as much.
To rebuild it new from scratch. Absolutely.
Correct.
Yeah. Point stipulated.
Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else has a thought about this before we go for a vote? No burning desire anywhere? All right. Call for the question. All in favor?
Can I amend my motion?
Absolutely.
Okay. So I'd like to amend my motion to adopt the resolution to name the county building at 142 North Adams as either the James Harris Building or the Jim Harris Building, dependent on the preference of Mrs. Harris, to be determined at a later date.
Okay, do I have a second?
Second.
All right. Any other discussion on that part? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. All righty. I have a motion for the consent calendar.
Move approval of the consent calendar.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All right. Any discussion about the consent calendar? Hearing none, seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
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 We don't have any late agenda items, so commissioner reports. John or Rod, who wants to go first?
I'll go first. At the last meeting, I kind of got tired of just telling people what meetings and where we've been during the last 2 weeks, and I decided instead to talk a little bit about the county. And I think there's a lot of things that a lot of people don't know about the county. I know when I took this position, I didn't know a lot about the county. At our last meeting, we talked about county finances. I'll recap that. The county in total has a budget of $130 million a year. Our property taxes paid for $6 million of that $130 million. The biggest share of the remaining part of the $130 million is paid for by dedicated money we get from either the federal or the state government for specific purposes, like the gas tax money goes to support the roads. We can't use that to fund the jail. Public health money comes from what's commonly called Obamacare, Medicaid, and it can't be used for general county functions. Our tax rate, the rate we charge the citizens for calculation of property taxes, at $1.08 per thousand, is the second lowest property tax rate in the state. It's 67%. Nearly just two-thirds of what the average county would charge for their operation. Our taxes currently stand at about 80%. Our property tax rate stands at about 80% of what it was 10 years ago. So I think we've done a good job of controlling our spending. Our number of employees used to be 550 almost, today we're around 330, 335. Your commission has done a good job, and your staff have done a good job of controlling costs and keeping our taxes low. So that's
just a recap of the week before last. This week, I'd like to talk about the county forest. It'll be very brief. We have a county forest, which is fairly unique amongst counties. One might ask, you know, why is the county engaging in an enterprise like having a forest? Shouldn't that be reserved for the private sector? I thought that when I came to work here at the county. I looked at the financial reality of it. Year in and year out, our county forest averages about a $3 million profit, and that's from 15,000 acres. We recently enlarged that forest, that acreage a bit, but 15,000 acres. Doing the math, that means that we get $200 per acre per year of contribution from the county forest to holding our tax rates low. If private enterprise owned that property, the tax proceeds to the county would be, instead of $200 per acre per year, would be in the range of 40 to 50 cents per acre per year. That justified to me, on behalf of the taxpayers of the county, that this was a good proposition for us to, a good thing for us to be involved with. A little bit more about the county forest, the 15,000 acres over the last half a dozen years has been increased to 17,000 acres. We've added 2,000 acres. Looking towards the future of the, that's the first time the county forest, I think, has been enlarged for ever since, practically since its inception. We run it very efficiently. We have a forestry department that consists of a forester and two assistants and a business manager. So four people run the forest. We contract out all the services, planting, weed control, all those things. We sell the, it's managed on a sustained yield basis. We sell about 350 acres, cutting rights about 350 acres per year. The buyer has 3 years in which to harvest those acres, and all the logs are used, are manufactured here in Oregon. None of the land is exported. None of the timber is exported. The biggest buyers here, the biggest buyer is Roseburg Forest Products, one of the county's major job providers. So that's it about the county forest. Thank you.
Run.
So it's been a busy couple of weeks since our last BOC meeting. We had the District 1 state representative seat to fill. That was a couple of different steps. I was involved in the PCP stage of that on the 28th. And then just a few last week, we had, of course, the vote here, and Court Voice was elected to that seat. We have, I had a really neat meeting about what's happening with the salmon and hatch program in conjunction with the Coquels and the STEP program. You know, there's, we don't always work in the same vein or with the same ideas as the Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife. I don't know if anybody's noticed that, but their values seem to be at odds with our values here in Coos County frequently. Well, here's a value we can all share. There's hatch boxes in our river system, our Coquille River system here. ODFMW does not know where they are. I like it that way. So that's good. We've seen, we saw a really good return of salmon to get eggs and sperm from, so we've got product to stock all those boxes, and I believe that work is all done now. So I'm really anticipating, hopefully in 3 or 4 years, to see some very strong runs back
from that project, and that's really great. And then, let's see, yesterday ran up to Salem to the AOC, Association of Oregon Counties Legislative Committee meeting. And then last night, of course, at the North Bend Homelessness Town Hall, which was basically discussing what the federal and state requirements are for a generation of a comprehensive plan on the part of municipalities and counties. And there were some good ideas expressed, there were some bad ideas expressed, and there is going to be more discussion on this topic that's going to involve, as we heard today in this meeting, involving the cities and the county working together. And so I'm really looking forward to being more involved in the solution, the long-term solution to that problem. And that's about all I got.
All righty, for me, I attended the same town hall last night and listened for, what, 2.5, 3 hours. And to me, it's, like I said before, this homeless problem is not fair to the neighbors to have to put up with this. And the, like, multiple people talk about Oak Street Park in North Bend, and they have to hire security to come and protect their homes at night, and they don't sleep well because there's a certain element that is not good for the community. There are others there that are good, but there's an element that needs some remuneration of some sort so that they are either incarcerated or whatever, or got off of their problems. And listening to all this last night, I'm thinking, well, the homeless part didn't come first. It came second after the drug problem. And I have a hard time understanding why all of us should have to pay for the 0.000 certain percent of people who choose that lifestyle. I just am having a, and it explained why the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals in San Francisco came up with a decision that you have to provide, if you don't have a place to provide them for a shelter, then you have to leave them in place if they're not causing issues like traffic control and all that kind of stuff. And I'm still going, now wait a minute. I could go on forever, but it just, I came home and started faunching my wife about it, going, what the heck is going on with America anyway? I attended a private session and a public session with Senator Merkley last Saturday at Marshfield High School, and you forgot that because Rod was there too listening. I tried to impress upon him about improving Coal River's hatchery so we can, if you don't know, a lot of the hatchery production for salmon and steelhead is done at Coal River's, which is the Lost Creek Dam on the upper road above Medford. They have massive problems. Their electrical line went out some years ago, and they've been powering the hatchery with diesel generators. The water flow comes from the impoundment, which is full of algae, and they used to have a filter on it. They took the filter off because it didn't plug, so they just run the algae right through the system, and they lost, this last winter, they lost all of the Eel 10-mile step steelhead. They lost half of the Coos River step steelhead, amongst all the other things. And now, of course, NOAA, et cetera, along with ODFW, is looking at closing Chinook season for the entire coast of Oregon. But if you don't put fish back in the system, how are you going to get them back? And it looks like they're being run by these, what I would call, native fish groups, where only good fish is a native fish coming back to the stream. Well, they don't realize that there have been hatcheries in Oregon and they're trading of fish since the late 1800s. So I wonder how many native fish there really are. I have debates with the biologists about that back and forth, and I don't seem to get anywhere. But we did the state rep selection, and I sat for a meeting on OPAC, Ocean Policy Advisory Commission. And I had some objections to their designating of five additional areas of marine, not reserves, but marine protected areas. One is Blacklock Point, just north of the Sixers River. And I said, we never had any public discussions on that. And oh my gosh, all the people who were in favor of that just said, oh, we did, and we had this and this and this. So I contacted my state senators and representatives and said, can you find out about that? Because I don't think they did. Because I talked to Senator David Brock Smith. He said, I don't remember anything like that. I talked to our new state rep, Court Boyce, and he said, I don't remember anything like that, which is in his county, Curry County. And so you're going, wait a minute. And to be on, if you don't know, to be on statewide committees now, you have to go through about a 45-minute to an hour course on management, including woke stuff, transgender stuff, all kinds of stuff like that. Then you have to take a test at the end. I'm going, what? You have to pass it with 80%, yes. Some of the questions I missed were, if a manager has it, doesn't know there's a problem in his management group, and there is a problem, that manager's held liable. Huh? How does that work? If you're unaware, how are you supposed to fix a problem? But some employee brings you, or brings to somebody else and files a suit that the manager didn't take care of it. When the manager didn't know anything about it, that manager, or the, in this case the county, would be liable? Huh? If you have a, quote, transgender person, where can they use the bathroom? I got it wrong. I said, well, either in the mail or a private bathroom. No, no, anywhere they want to. Huh? So either male or female, whichever that person happens to be originally, is going into the other one, or is that group that's, let's say, females and this transgender guys going into their bathroom, how safe do you feel with that person in there, or in the shower or whatever else? That's just baloney. That's just totally wrong. But we seem to be in the media quite often, and our, some of our, well, I call them, I don't know what the term would be for legislators, but not certainly for the people passing these laws that we're supposed to all live by, just totally wrong. I guess that's enough of my soapbox. And we are adjourned. Thank you all. And anybody wants to come up and talk, hey, come on up. We're going to sign papers, and we can talk at the same time.